Hey guys, Pratima here. So Samsung has finally unveiled its new Galaxy S21 lineup of phones and the Galaxy Buds Pro in a virtual Unpacked event tonight. And I have been testing out all of these devices for a little over 3 days now. And in this video, I will be talking about the S21 Ultra, which is the best Samsung has to offer for now with the spec sheet to prove it. A big 6.82 inches quad HD display that can finally go up to 120Hz, Snapdragon 888 or Exynos 2100 chipset, 12GB of base RAM, the new and improved cameras, and a big 5000mAh battery. So yeah, it's got the standard high-end stuff. And you might remember that the last-gen Galaxy S20 and S20 Ultra received some mixed reviews, at least in this part of the world, because, you guessed it, the Exynos 990 chipset. But not only that, the S20 Ultra had this unfixable camera autofocus issue, which the company largely addressed with multiple firmware updates, but since that was the focal length issue of the huge 108MP sensor, it was beyond repair. Anyways, after using it for a couple of days now, I feel like the S21 Ultra has brought many improvements in almost all the areas you'd expect, but the biggest one has to be in the performance department, all thanks to the Exynos 2100 chipset it has. You might be dying to know its real-life benchmark score, so I will get right to it. Unfortunately, I could not run the AnTuTu benchmark because it continuously gave me an error message. Regardless, let's pit the Exynos 2100 against last year's Exynos 990. In Geekbench 5, as you can see, it has a 23% higher single-core score, whereas the multi-core performance is around 41% faster. Moving to PC Mark IV 2.0, the Exynos 2100 delivers more than 25% higher score than the 990. Similarly, in 3D Mark, which benchmarks CPU and GPU performance of a phone, the Exynos 2100 wins out with a lead of around 23%. Besides benchmarks, the S21 Ultra also feels more optimized, and the new One UI 3.1 complements the performance really nicely. Everything is smoother than what we saw on the Exynos 990 powered phones last year. Moreover, the heating issue is gone for good as well. I also like how swiping left on the home screen now takes you to the Google News feed. But the age-old question remains, does it hold up against the Snapdragon 888? If you look at the CPU architecture of these silicons, they are basically the same. Still, I'm not quite sure if the Mali G78 GPU on the Exynos 2100 is on the same level as the Adreno 660. For that, we will just have to wait a while for some head-on comparisons. During my test, I played a lot of games on this phone and it definitely seems to be doing a better job than the Exynos 990. Even after an hour or more of continuously PUBG Mobile gameplay, this thing does not heat up, whereas Exynos 990 used to throttle bad. Still, there is no 90 FPS gameplay on PUBG and the highest you can go is smooth graphics and extreme frame rates here. So this is one area where Samsung can eventually optimize certain games to run at a higher graphics settings. Other than that, games like Call of Duty and Genshin Impact are quite optimized and run at the highest of settings, which is great. If you have been following the ongoing virtual CES 2021, multiple router manufacturers like TP-Link, Netgear, and Linksys have announced their Wi-Fi 6E capable routers. And if you manage to get your hands on one in due time, the entire Galaxy S21 series will be able to take full advantage of it as these devices support the newer and faster Wi-Fi 6E standard. Moving on, another aspect I really like about the S21 Ultra is its design. It's lighter than the S20 Ultra and is more ergonomic to hold and definitely not as heavy as the iPhone 12 Pro Max that I've been using as my primary phone. The Phantom Black variant that I have with me comes off elegant and is mesmerizing to look at. It's a matte black and not pitch black and therefore radiates a Batmobile vibe. However, if this does not float your boat, there are other color options to choose from like silver, gray, navy, and brown. The camera lens setup gets a redesign and I find the new approach to be more modern, unique, and soluble. Its camera bump isn't that big either, so yeah, it's unquestionably a better implementation than what we saw on the S20 and Note 20 Ultra. The Galaxy S21 Ultra also comes with the Gorilla Glass Victus protection on the back and at the front for greater durability, just like the Note 20 Ultra. However, the Phantom Black color variant and its close to matte finish feels unlike nothing like glass on the hand. It is smooth with a great tactile feel and does not easily attract smudges either. The frames are metal, as expected, and this time around there is no SD card support on the S21 Ultra. So be wise when choosing the memory option appropriate for you. Let's get to the display now, and like I mentioned earlier, the S21 Ultra greets you with a 6.82 inches 1440p 120Hz screen, and as far as I can tell, this is probably the best display on a smartphone yet. It can get plenty bright, up to 1500 nits, and the contrast, the colors on it is extremely good. In comparison, it brags 25% brighter and 50% enhanced contrast ratio compared to previous Galaxy S devices. Moreover, Samsung is finally letting you crank up the resolution to QHD while retaining the 120Hz smoothness. And just like the Note 20 Ultra and the Z Fold 2 before it, this screen boasts LTPO technology that can dynamically switch the refresh rate between 10Hz to 120Hz depending upon the content on your screen. Samsung has something in store for the flat display enthusiasts this time around, as the regular S21 and the S21 Plus skip the curves while only the Ultra goes for a curved screen. Anyway, one of the biggest leaks surrounding the S21 series was how it would replace the company's Note lineup of flagship phones by including an S Pen, as the Galaxy S21 Ultra will instead bring S Pen functionality by embedding the stylus inside a case. So if you want S Pen on your S21 Ultra, you're gonna have to buy an additional folio case. Still, being able to use a stylus on an S series phone is a welcome addition nonetheless. Likewise, the ultrasonic fingerprint sensor also sees an improvement. The Galaxy S21 series embed Qualcomm's second generation ultrasonic fingerprint reader. Compared to the last gen sensor on the Note 20 Ultra, this one is about 30% faster with a 77% larger surface area. Finally, let's talk cameras. It's equipped with four sensors, including an upgraded 108MP ISOCELL HM3 sensor with OIS. Unlike the S20 Ultra's 108MP lens with 3D time of flight, this new sensor uses laser autofocus. Then there's the 12MP ultra-wide-angle camera and two telephoto cameras, a 10x folded periscope lens equivalent to 240mm and a traditional 3x telephoto lens. Both use 10MP sensors. This hybrid zoom will ensure a smooth transition between focal lengths. I compared its zoom capabilities against the iPhone 12 Pro Max that has 2.5x optical zoom. As expected, the S21 Ultra completely trashes the iPhone. From 3x to 10x zoom, the S21 Ultra is better in every way. Even 3x zoom night mode images are quite good. According to Samsung, the periscope lens system that is used to achieve 10x zoom needs to refract light only twice. In comparison, the periscope lens solution for telephoto cameras on other smartphones require up to 5 refractions. Fewer refractions mean relatively higher image quality, and with the new and improved image signal processor, we are looking at one of the best smartphone telephoto cameras in the industry. Other than that, the other two lenses, wide and ultra-wide, are pretty much on par with my current primary phone, that is the iPhone 12 Pro Max. And one thing I've noticed on the S21 Ultra is that its images are not as spongy and vibrant as we're used to on previous Samsung flagships. As a result, the S21 Ultra shoots more natural-looking photos. When it comes to nighttime shots, both the iPhone 12 Pro Max and the S21 Ultra do a commendable job. But in instances with little to low ambient light, night mode images from the S21 Ultra looks better. Portrait photos are equally good from both the phones, but the iPhone is able to churn out slightly more details with mildly better skin tone on most occasions. However, the S21 Ultra isn't that far behind and in certain scenarios shoots better portrait shots. Similarly, its laser autofocus system works fine, slightly better than on the Note 20 Ultra. But I still feel like it's nowhere near the dual pixel autofocus that we used to see on Samsung flagship phones in the past. When trying to take close-up macro shots, the S21 Ultra finds it difficult to lock focus, but Samsung has this new feature called Focus Enhancer, which turns on automatically when taking macro photos. In the end, the images do retain good subject focus, although there is no natural background bokeh. As for selfies, the centered punch hole cutout on the S21 Ultra houses a new 40MP sensor. I compared it against the iPhone 12 Pro Max as well. Both phones do a commendable job. While the shots from the iPhone feature a slightly darker skin tone, the S21 brightens up the subject by a bit. Nonetheless, both devices offer top-tier selfie cameras. Getting to the videos, the S21 Ultra's rear camera tops out at 8K 24fps with the 4K 60fps option as well. We all know how good Apple is when it comes to videos and its superiority in terms of stabilization and color science. Still and all, videos from Samsung's Galaxy S21 Ultra is competent enough for shooting great videos. There's also a slight improvement in terms of 8K videos. Although there's no stabilization, the software does an okay job. But if you wish to shoot still footages in 8K resolution, the S21 Ultra can deliver decent videos. Overall, I am really impressed with its cameras, and since I'm using the preliminary software, I expect it to be even better when I get the final retail unit and Samsung rolls out a few more updates to further optimize the cameras. So stay tuned for my full long-term review and detailed camera comparison with the iPhone 12 Pro Max. On to the battery side of things, the S21 Ultra is powered by a 5000 mAh cell, which is pretty much the standard these days. I got about a day's endurance, so I have to say that the battery life is pretty good. However, Samsung could have further optimized it though, since I recorded 5-6% of battery drain overnight, which has never been an issue with the iPhones. Having said that, charging of the phone is pretty fast. I used the 25-watt power delivery charger of last year's Galaxy Note 20 Ultra, and it can fully charge the phone in under an hour. S21 Ultra's audio quality is pretty impressive as well. It is loud and detailed enough to immerse yourself in the content you're watching. Been stuck here in a bed for days. I've been staring at the telephone, 'cause when you're gone, I miss your face. Okay, let's bring this review to a conclusion. After the disappointment that was the Galaxy S20 Ultra, Samsung has made a strong comeback with the S21 Ultra. It packs the best of everything, from the display, cameras, processor, and more. So Samsung is off to a great start this year with the new Galaxy S21 series. But everything comes at a price, and the new Galaxy S21 Ultra is still cost a pretty penny. Yet, the silver lining here is that Samsung offers some lucrative pre-booking offers and free insurance in many markets like South Asia. And while the regular S21 Plus might suffice for many, if you want the absolute best that Samsung has to offer for now, the Galaxy S21 Ultra is it. So that was all for our review of the new Galaxy S21 Ultra. We're thinking of making a camera comparison between the iPhone 12 Pro Max and the S21 Ultra, so make sure you subscribe to our channel. Till then, I'm Pratima Adhikari, and I'll see you in the next video.